podcast where we put you on the map. This is Ron Costa broadcasting live in the Mapable USA studios here in Las Vegas, Nevada. And folks, today we're going to talk about a subject that not too many people have heard of before. It's called coronavirus. I'm only kidding. Everyone knows what it is. But today we're going to take it from another perspective and find out what's out there. We're going to talk about it from a data-driven approach. And to do that, let's start by introducing Vicki Hutchmala from the QOZ Marketplace. Vicki, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, Ron. Beautiful day in Vegas. Sunny, hot, lovely. Today we have an excellent guest. He's one of our favorite guests on the podcast, and he's going to tell us all about how the coronavirus is affecting us and how we can get back into a normal state. So can't wait.
Yes, so let's introduce once again Neal-bawa from Grocapitus Investments and Multifamily U, big friend of the show, and we're a big fan of his. Neal, how are you doing today?
Fantastic. Just as sunny and beautiful here in California. So, I'm smiling.
Very
yes.
Good.
Well, you have to be, Neal, because you're like Mr. Podcast, Mr. Webinar these days. I know you're doing a lot of webinars, and you're keeping everybody up to date with what's going on this whole coronavirus issue from a real estate perspective and so many different angles. So I don't know how you do it, but you're doing it. It's great.
I think it lends itself well to what we do. We're a very research-heavy organization. We're very data-driven, and so we've always done data-driven events, but, where 100 people would show up to our webinars before, now we have 800 people showing up because this is simply the most important topic in the world and from any aspect. And obviously, we take a real estate spin to it, but a lot of the data is really something that anyone in any area could understand, which is why we've seen such a massive increase. We're doing a podcast, for some podcaster every day. And we're doing a webinar and a town hall every week, and people can't seem to get enough of it.
Yeah, well,
that's
seen
because
obviously
you're such a great guest, Neal. You
yes.
have so much information to give to everybody, and they enjoy listening to you. Let me ask you a question. What?
Yeah, I think it's
and
my haircut.
Tell us how wonderful
I think it's my new haircut. Or the lack thereof. I mean, I haven't had a haircut in 2.5 months, so I'm beginning to look more and more hippie-ish, and I think people find that interesting.
Take them back to the good old days, especially in San Francisco.
All we have to do is put a guitar in Neal's hands, or maybe we could sing this podcast. What do you think?
I think we should try that. I'm just about ready to do that because I'm going completely batshit crazy, sitting at home every day.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And Neal, obviously we've all felt the effects of this whole coronavirus thing on mm-hmm. so many different levels, and it's happening now. We've been through March, which lasted, 97 days, and today's mm-hmm. the end of April, which was like, 127 days, something like that, it seems like.
Oh, I know.
But now yeah. we're actually at the point now where I think we can see some maybe a recovery perhaps and actually use some mm-hmm. data that we've seen before to look forward to this and see what's going to happen. What are you seeing in the near term and the far term on this? What's going to happen?
Well, we're definitely seeing some good trends and some bad trends. So we'll share both of those. I love sharing the good news first. So one of the things that we're seeing is that the world is really gearing up, and the world was the industrialized world was extremely slow to react to this. Countries like Singapore were very quick because they had been through the SARS epidemic. South Korea was quick, again, because of SARS and MERS. The rest of the Europe and America were extraordinarily slow, unfortunately, with the United States being the slowest country to react. And if you don't agree with that, and that's not a political statement, it's not a Republican versus Democrat statement. We were unquestionably the slowest in the world to react. And if you'd like to learn more about that, go to a website called Our World in Data. Our World in Data, and click on their COVID tracker. This is a data-driven organization of scientists, and they basically present data as it is, good, bad, or ugly. And I think you'll immediately, slide one, you'll see why the United States was the slowest to react. But that was the past. What we are seeing today is that every day, our ability to fight this invisible enemy is improving. So, you know, just like this is an exponential, you know, virus where it goes 1, 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, and it went up like crazy, and now we have 3 million cases worldwide. We've got, you know, hundreds of thousands of deaths. In the same way, our ability to fight the virus is now also growing exponentially because we are readily sharing information between countries. We're sharing resources. We're sharing medication information. And so the world is actually gearing up well in the last 20 or 30 days because until then, there was still some skepticism about this. Now we're at the point where we are beyond the skepticism. We're beyond the gloom. We're beyond the, oh, my God, this is going to happen. We're like, we've adjusted our reality to, hey, we're in the middle of it. Now let's make the best of it. So I see a lot of that happening. I see a lot of very positive news coming out. For example, the European Union just approved a kit that allows for antibody testing. That's a wonderful scenario. It's mostly for healthcare professionals, not for end users. We're beginning to see that it may be possible to get a vaccine in 9 to 12 months instead of 18 to 24 months. So that's a good positive step. We're also beginning to see us take a very in-depth approach to reopening, right? So before, 30 days ago, people were simply saying, you know, when we're done with this, we're going to reopen the economy. And we all know that that's not going to work. The data clearly shows that the R-naught or the infectious level of this virus is far too high for you to reopen. But now we're seeing a very granular, thoughtful approach being taken. Doesn't matter which government you're talking, which state government you're talking about, they're really thinking this through, right? And so what we're beginning to see is a gradual opening of the economy where portions of the economy that are less at risk are going to reopen, and states are learning from each other. They're looking at what everyone else is doing. We're looking at what Sweden's doing. Sweden never shut down their economy. So it hasn't been a very successful experiment, but parts of it were successful. They've been able to track what was the most dangerous thing that they reopened. Was it the movie theaters? Was it the restaurants, right? What makes sense? And a lot of logic is being used, which I think is going to improve our chances of staying open. For example, California is thinking of a hybrid year. They're thinking of a hybrid school year, and they're thinking of starting it in July. And you might think, why start in July? Well, because it helps people get back to work when their kids are not at home. So they're thinking of restarting in July and having a hybrid session where some kids are taking, you know, and they're spreading out the classes by using Zoom as a technology where people some of the time they're in class and some of the time they're in a different room. And these kinds of creative ideas, this kind of creative thinking really wasn't there 30 to 45 days ago. And all of it helps keep that R-naught of this virus down below 1%, below 1. Because remember, if one person infects more than one person, sooner or later, you have to go into a shutdown again. But if one person infects 0.7 person or 0.8 or 0.2, then you can keep your economy going and deal with the healthcare consequences of the virus itself. I'm not in favor of just saying, let's just shut everything down until we get a virus, because there's a massive amount of damage done to our economy. And at some point, that damage and the number of deaths that are caused from an economic depression are far greater than the healthcare damage, than those deaths. So one has to balance both.
That is a great point. That's an outstanding point right there.
Right. Let me give you an example of that, because people don't talk about this enough. So in an economic depression, we've seen countries like Venezuela go into an economic depression. We've seen Argentina go into an economic depression. And so we actually have statistics that show us that anytime a country goes into an economic depression, there are hundreds of thousands, if not millions of deaths that are related to food shortages, lack of quality health care, people just simply not being able to live a healthy and safe lifestyle. So there's a massive number of deaths that happen because of that. And we've already started seeing that economic impact of COVID-19 across the United States. The number of homelessness is up, and the homeless that were basically waiting outside of restaurants at midnight, waiting for those restaurants to throw out food, they don't have food anymore because those restaurants are not operational. Restaurants were doing a great service to America, by giving away that food at midnight when they were done, or at 11 o'clock, well, those restaurants are closed now. So there is a death toll that is also connected with keeping the country closed. And people are beginning to understand that this is not a one-sided equation. And that new knowledge, that new thinking, I'm seeing it across the country. And I think it is a good thing. I mean, I'm seeing what Apple and Google are doing. They're building tools into their operating systems, not an app, but a tool that is actually built into their OS. Both companies will have this API. They call it an application programming interface. It's going to be ready at the end of this month. And what that means is anyone can build an application, allowing them to track their population and do it in a way that is not considered a privacy issue, right? So a lot of people are afraid to install that app. I'm going to install it the moment it comes out, because I think that we have a duty to this country at this point to allow, you know, them to track us in a private fashion. And it's also better for me. If the company reopened and I went into an area that was fairly congested and the healthcare authorities know that there was somebody there that was infectious, I want to know about it. I want to know that I might be infected so that I can protect my father and my mother when I come back home. And those apps, you're going to see them come out within the next 30 to 40 days. And that will help. Not everyone will sign up for those apps, but tens of millions of people in America will, and that's going to help. So we're beginning to see America apply its ingenuity, its entrepreneurs to this. Yes, we may have been the slowest to get started, but I think we're beginning to catch up. Testing is going up every day. We were doing 50,000 tests a day, then 100,000, then 150,000, then 200,000. Looks like we're above 250,000 tests a day today. And I think we're going to be at 350,000 tests within 10 days when America really starts to reopen. Big states like California start to open. And so in a way, our ability to fight with this virus is so much stronger than it was 30 days ago.
Well, and you know, I think that the reason for that is once people got it out of their head and the fear left and the, oh my God, we're going to die kind of attitude, and that passed, then they could start applying their ingenuity to, well, how do we fix it? Well, what do we do? Well, what do we need? And then, boom, that spark of entrepreneurship, that spark of creativity and imagination set in, and now we have all of these things happening to bring us out of it, to bring it out of it safely, to bring us out of it so that there's the least damage as possible, and to keep us safe for the future, to make sure that if this should come back again in the fall or the winter, that we're prepared, we're better prepared, and we're not going to go through it. But you had to get rid of that fear factor first before you could start to logically think about it.
Yes, and mentally we're much more prepped. For example, California is showing off these models of new classrooms that have these yellow arrows for kids to walk through. They're, you know, kids are now getting used to wearing masks. And if you had told me that my kid had to wear a mask to go to school 60 days ago, that would have been a problem for me. But today it's not. So society adjusts. So today,
exactly,
I'm okay with my kid going to school in a mask. I'm okay with there being a structured time where every 2 hours you have to go to a hand washing station and wash their hands. So teachers are being told, well, there's going to be a hand washing time. So at 11, everybody washes hands. And at 1 o'clock, everybody washes hands. And then we do it again at 3 o'clock. This is very important because this virus is not magic. It's simply a dumb virus. And if we can be creative about how we handle this, it's going to be great. Companies
exactly.
like Google are now talking about, you know, sure, we have 80,000 employees to bring in, but we're going to basically, previously employees could come and leave any time. Now we're going to rotate them. Some people can come in at 7 and can work at 2 and then go back and work the rest of the day. And that way we've kind of seen them in the office. We've gotten that physical connection, but they're still working from the office the rest of the time. And there's going to be some people who, at their option, can actually work Saturday and Sunday, so they're not crowding the workplace on the weekdays. This sort of thinking just didn't exist 30 days ago. And so I think that's the good news that we are seeing in the economy, that everyone's gotten past the grumpy phase, and now they're into the oh, what, let's reopen this economy. And, I mean, and that's the good news. And there's plenty of bad news, and I'll share that as well. But I think that the good news is really that the world has really begun to adjust to this new reality and what it means for us.
That's
true. And Neal, I see about three types of people with this, the way that they look at this coronavirus. There's the group of people who are using this as kind of like a vacation, and they're binge watching all their favorite shows on Netflix, and they're kind of like, oh, you know, whatever happens, happens. You got your people there who are all doom and gloom, and it's never going to come back. This is horrible. We're done for. And then you got the people who are like refocusing their lives and trying to make something of this and looking forward. And I'm imagining those are the type of people that are attending your webinars and the type of people who are really will get a lot out of the data that you bring to the table on your websites and all the things that you're doing as well. So I think that's the key part of this, which you just mentioned. That's the good news. The good news is that we're going to make it out of this, and the world's going to change a little bit, but there is, you know, a bright spot to this, innovation. Like you just said, you know, American ingenuity, it's great.
Yeah.
And everyone's doing it in a different fashion. So, you know, I was telling people said, you know, it's really hard to make investments today. And I said, no. That's not true. It's really easy to make investments today. So he asked me, apart from real estate, Neal, you know, you're a real estate guy. So what should I be investing in besides real estate? So I said, well, I would be investing in any company that's producing thermal imaging equipment. That's a really easy one. So we saw what happened with SARS and MERS. Every airport in Asia installed thermal scanners to scan people for temperature, right? Now imagine every airport in the world, every railway station in the world, every conference center, every stadium, every major place that people gather, even large schools installing thermal scanners. I think we need 50x as many thermal scanners as we have. There's companies that manufacture them that are publicly traded like FLIR. That's opportunity. You have to think that way. There is more opportunity in bad times than there is good times. So I provided that as an example. And people were like, wow, that makes a lot of sense. And I reminded them that the biggest boom industry in the world after 9/11 was airport scanners, right? Those big scanners mm-hmm. that we have now all become used
right.
to. And imagine
right.
how much money those companies made. And now we need – but that was just airports. There's thousands of different types of places where people gather, right? And every conference center in the world is going to need conference scanners because – because if people know that they have a fever and they look up at the scanner and they're passing through and there's this big TV showing a whole bunch of blue blobs and then there's a red blob, that person who's looking at the screen is going to say, am I that red blob? Oh, my God, I've got a fever. I'm going to leave, mm-hmm. right? So people are also becoming socially better at this. The bottom line is there's opportunities being created today. And either you can sit at home and mope about things, or you can start looking at this as a new world of opportunity. So FLIR is a perfect example of the sort of companies that are benefiting at this point in time. They can't make enough product today. They can't even make enough product 6 months from now. They can't make enough product 2 years from now. Because every single place in the world that gathers thousands of people is going to need these scanners.
That's true. And opportunities come, and you're correct, when – this is a time for opportunities, but there are different types of opportunities than people are used to because it's a different time. It's a crazy time, and we have to adapt, and that adaptation to life is creating opportunities if you can have the vision to see, well, now we need scanners. Maybe we need scanners that are UV scanners. Maybe that the virus can be addressed and destroyed using UV light. So now let's go into that and see how that can help us. Aside from just looking for the virus for the vaccine that's going to kill the virus, now there's a whole new concept out there of how to control the virus in open spaces where people gather so we can go back to creating the economy that we had 2, 3, 4 months ago when everything was mm-hmm. bright and wonderful.
Yep, and there's so many different aspects of that. People said, you know, what else, Neal? I said, I think there's going to be a thriving business of people that are going to go to restaurant owners and say, give us your menu and we'll come back to you in a few hours with a very low cost printed version of the menu so that you can give out the menu as a disposable menu. Restaurants don't have the time to find the lowest cost, but they want something that is cheap. And then, you know, if sure, they can laser print it, but that's going to cost them a lot of money and a lot of time to laser print their menu and hand it out to every single person that comes in through the door. I'm convinced that there's solutions that cost one-fifth or one-tenth of that. And so there's profit to be made there, right? Because I think menus are going to go disposable worldwide, which means that we are going to need literally tens of billions of menus.
That's right.
So the people are going to come up with solutions to everything. And so there's this humongous amount of ingenuity that is in play here.
And it's not just to rethink what we need and how we live our lives, but a lot of these companies are now short in capital and investments. And so they need to not only redesign how they do things, but they have to do it at a more economical, a cheaper way, because they have less money to spend to be innovative. They have to innovate and do it with no money. And that creates a whole new place and a whole new, opens up a whole new opportunity for opportunity.
Yeah, and I mean, here's an example. I want to give you this as an example of American ingenuity. So, you know, there's this concept called shale oil, right? So shale oil is hydraulic fracturing of stones to get oil out of them. So it's not a traditional oil pump. And back in 2009 and 2010, the American shale oil revolution started. And back then, their break-even cost was about $70 a barrel. But that was okay, because if you remember, in 2008, oil was very expensive. And so, you know, those companies were doing well. But then oil got cheap again. And so everyone started saying gloom and doom, you know, the shale oil revolution is going to go away. And in 2010, 2011, we're going to have a bust. Guess what happened? They realized that they needed to pump oil out of the ground at a cheaper price. So they went through a series of technological innovations where their break-even point went from 65 to 60 to 55 to 40 to 35 to $30 a barrel. Now today, of course, the price of oil is even lower than $30 a barrel, but I think that's a temporary thing. When the economy reopens, you'll see the price of oil go up to $40 or $50 a barrel, maybe not 60 or 70, but it'll go back up to, you know, it beyond their break even. Right. So that industry, it adapted. And I think that what people are just thinking is that restaurants will simply disappear. Many of them, lots of them will disappear. But what you're going to see is that people are going to adapt to this environment. And some of it will be painful, because I believe that the cost of eating at restaurants over the next 3 months is going to be 40 or 50% higher, because they can't have the same density. They're going to raise the cost, and some of us will have to pay that short-term pain. I think a year from now, restaurant prices will come back down when we get a vaccine, when we get past this problem. But for the next year, I think we have to share the pain with the restaurants, and one way we're going to do that is it's going to be more expensive to eat out than it was in February. So these are all things that we'll adapt to.
Mm-hmm. And restaurants are going to have to change their menu. And because they have less people, because it's going to be more expensive, they're going to have to change the items on that menu to make it more affordable, so people can go into the restaurant or digitally go to the menu and order takeout or have it delivered or whatever. So the whole concept of restaurants are going to change. The menu, the prices, the way they operate, the way they do business, every industry, as you say, every industry is going to have to adapt to a new world. And in the end, it will be a much better world than it was 2 or 3 months ago, where everybody was comfortable and everything was going along. Now we're in a new place. We're in a new time, and we have the opportunity to change the world for the better and make it better as we go forward, until some other new crisis comes and changes the world again. Because humanity has to survive. Its basic instinct is survival, and it will adapt to whatever is necessary to maintain that survival. And it's just natural human nature.
Go ahead.
That's all the good news. I'm sitting down, Neal. What's the bad news on this?
Well, it's tied to the survival comment that Vicky made. So what we are seeing is, we now have data coming in from China about what happens when a major economy that has been forced to shut down reopens. So, what, you know, first thing we're looking at is coal. So we're looking at their industry, and their coal usage appears to have only rebounded to about 85% of what it was before, which is a huge concern, because if China only produces 85% of the goods that it was producing, then the world goes into a serious depression. So I think we're going to see governments take more extraordinary action once they reopen, because the chances that the United States can go back to 100% of its output after it reopens are remote, are extremely remote. We're beginning to see just how much damage the Chinese economy has sustained. And so, and one of the ways you can see that is look at their traffic patterns. So traffic in Shanghai and Beijing and in Guangzhou and in all of their big cities is up to about 90% of what it was when they were shut down, or before they were shut down. But on the weekends, the traffic is negligible. So people, even though they can leave their houses now, they have no restrictions, they're still choosing not to leave. So their recreational time is it almost feels like, you know, the Saturdays and Sundays have some sort of a curfew, even though there's no, the government saying nothing about people staying at home, but they're staying at home anyway. So there's going to be a phase when the U.S. reopens when we have to figure out how to get people out of their homes, because they're getting so used to being at home. And this virus is still out there, though it's probably far less infectious at the end of May than it was in the middle of March. I mean, you know, the shutdowns have significantly reduced the overall infection rate in the U.S., massively reduced it, and will have reduced by the time we really start to reopen. I know there's some small, you know, reopening things going on this week, but really a lot of the reopening of the U.S. happens in the second half of May, starting from the 15th of May. So by that time, the overall infection rate will be down, but people are also not logical about that. We're not seeing the Chinese economy have the same sort of, you know, food and recreation and travel, you know, or domestic travel things that they did before. We're not seeing that same level of interest. And so I think that the bad news is that the government will have to take a lot of steps to get people to spend money, because we're not seeing that happen in the Chinese economy at this point in time. We're seeing less real estate transactions happen in China. We're seeing less consumption. You know, they're buying less iPads and buying less Coach bags, and that is something that we need to happen to come back to where we were. So you're going to see a massive wave of, you know, pushes from governments to get people to buy stuff like cars. So do you remember the Cash for Clunkers program that we had in 2009 and 2010? Do you remember that one?
Oh, yeah.
I am forecasting that the most countries in the world will do some kind of a Cash for Clunkers program to restart expensive industries like cars, to restart, you know, these kinds of industries, because I think those industries are going to be very hard hit. I think that there's going to be subsidies for domestic and international travel once the virus is under control. Obviously, the virus is not under control. Nobody's going to do that for travel because people are afraid that that's going to, you know, increase infection. So I think that the governments have to play a huge role. We are not seeing economies rebound back to the same level. And I want to remind listeners that a typical U.S. recession is a reduction of 2 to 5% of GDP. China currently appears to be at 85% of its GDP, which means it's lost a catastrophic 15% of its GDP. That puts China in depression mode, not in recession mode. Now, it's early days, so we do know and we do hope that every day that GDP level is going to go up from 85, and after a week it's going to be 86 and 87. And if it keeps rising back up to the mid-90s, then it turns into a recession, which we know we're already in. You know, the Fed at this point is let us know that, you know, GDP contracted in Q1. Q2 obviously is going to be a much bigger contraction, so we know we're in a recession. So the world can sustain a recession, but with extraordinarily high levels of debt all over the world, we cannot sustain a depression. And right now, when the economy of the world reopens, right, Germany's going to start reopening next week, and Spain's going to start reopening the week after that. When it reopens, it doesn't appear to be reopening at that 100% level or even the 90% level. So you're going to see extraordinary government stimulus so that people can really get the engine of the economy going again. That has become very obvious in the last 2 weeks.
Well, and I think a lot of it has to do with the safety factor. The mm-hmm. more people feel safe in going mm-hmm. out and doing things, especially recreational and buying in malls and spending money, has, I believe, a lot to do with how safe they feel and mm-hmm. the population density that creates that fear of not being safe. And who am I standing next to, or am I going to get this from that? And a lot of it is education on how the virus spreads and what to do and what not to do and how to react if you're in a situation that may not be as safe as you thought you were when you were sitting at home doing nothing. So the more that companies, governments, and countries can eliminate that fear of being out in public, the more the economy will come back at a faster or slower rate, depending on how they address the fear factor.
You hit it on the head. I think psychologically, it's a psychological issue. This country moving about in a mall on May 15th or May 30th in the United States is massively safer than moving around in a mall on March 15th, 2 months ago.
Absolutely.
Right? Because right. the level of infection is down greatly, like massively greater, right? But on March 15th, the states that weren't shut down, there were tens of millions of people in malls and going to movie theaters and doing all of the typical sorts of things. Today, none of those people want to do it, and we have to basically get them comfortable to that point. So this really goes back to the concept of extraordinarily high levels of testing. And I think that that's what the United States needs to do better, that we need to basically make testing such a big part of citizens' lives that I drive out, I'm going to a movie theater, and there's this little kiosk outside. I do my little test. They do the swab. You know, on my smartphone, I have an app. They scan that app, so now they know who I am, and they send me my results later, and I go in and watch my movie. And in case there's a problem, just in case there's somebody infected there, that, you know, then everybody else knows about that, and they go into self-quarantine, and then they finish that and move on with their life. It hasn't affected the whole country. It's just affected a small number of people in a small number of movie theaters. That is the process that we have to go through, and governments are beginning to understand that they cannot have February's economy if they do not invest a massive amount of money giving their citizens the confidence that they're safe.
And it's, I think it's not just the testing factor. Yes, okay, so everybody gets tested, everybody finds out, everybody knows what their situation is in terms of whether they have or been exposed to the virus or what have you. But beyond that, there has to be a solution as well. So, okay, I go to a movie, I find out I sat next to somebody, he's had the virus, now I'm exposed to it. Okay, now what do? I go home, I quarantine or whatever, but that doesn't make me feel safe for the next time I go out. So in conjunction with the testing, I think that you need to have a solution. There needs to be something that is preemptive that says, okay, you can be safe. Even though you've been tested, you can be safe in this place because we have something to give you to that will help you to not get it. Or if you get it, that will take it away quickly, will destroy it. Or we have a device like the scanners. We have a device that will clean the air. So even if you're in a movie house or you've gone to a mall or someplace where there's a congregation of people, you also know that the likelihood of exposure is less because they've done things ahead of time to sanitize, to clean, and to keep me safe so that I feel comfortable.
I think that some of these are not things that we are ready for. You know, we're not ready for that kind of technological solution. Obviously, everyone is going to sanitize and clean, but we know that that has limited impact. I mean, there is impact, but it's still limited. I think that the part of it that we are close to is that we may take 12 to 18 months to come up with a vaccine. But if we could come up with a drug that cures it once you get it, or it makes your symptoms much less dangerous, then that could really help the psyche of the people. And the Gilead drug remdesivir seems to be the most likely option there. We have a drug that seems to make the virus's symptoms, reduce the symptoms, reduce the death rate. And if we can get remdesivir into the marketplace, people will be like, yeah, okay, maybe it's possible that I might get it. But firstly, I might have no symptoms like a whole bunch of people, or I might have light symptoms like a whole bunch of people. Or yeah, there's possibility that I'll end up in a hospital and they'll administer this drug and then I'll come home. Right now, that fear of dying is really what's keeping people at home. The Chinese people are staying at home because they're afraid that they'll die if they get this.
Exactly. And I mm-hmm. think that it's a conjunction between the pharmaceuticals and what you can do in terms of the virus pharmaceutically, but it also is a technology aspect too. What kind of technology can be created that will sanitize the whole of the space, not just each person, that goes beyond hand sanitizers, that goes beyond the disinfectants, that and goes beyond the pharmaceuticals, so that a whole space becomes disinfected instead of a person. And once we get to that point where pharmaceuticals and technology are working in conjunction with each other, you completely eliminated the fear factor.
Yeah, absolutely. I think those are all the things that we have to do. And I think the biggest thing is that we have a population that's now more ready to take orders. We have people
exactly.
that are much more compliant than they were a month
exactly.
or 2 months ago. We can do things that we couldn't even imagine 2 months ago. But I do still think that we're going to see some extraordinary things happen. So I'm going to,
absolutely.
You know, throw my, yeah, I'm going to stick my neck out there and say, we're going to see some tax holidays. We're going to see tax holidays to get people into malls. We're going to
yes.
see tax holidays for people to buy cars. We're going to see a encouragement of consumption of the kind that we have never seen in the history of mankind. We will
yeah.
see, and we will, and this will happen at a time when states and local bodies need more taxes. So the federal government is going to have to play a big role because states are already going bankrupt. But we are also going to see on the bad side some bankruptcies. I think that the state of Michigan
yeah.
is at severe risk. I think that New Jersey could be at risk. I think Puerto Rico could be at risk. So you've got certain states that are going to declare bankruptcies, and that will have a cascade effect on our economy. So on the bad side, the chances that we get out of this without a large municipality, without a large city, without a large state declaring bankruptcy are zero, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Right? So I,
yeah,
if I had to pick one, I would say Cook County in Chicago, which encompasses, Cook County is – the city of Chicago is part of Cook County, so that's kind of one potential. The state of Illinois itself, the state of Michigan, these are really places that are going to not receive adequate bailouts, and they're going to have to, you know, because of our we have partisan politics in the United States, so the chances that these places get bailed out are lower than they would otherwise be. So I do see massive bankruptcies in some of those areas. I also see potentially some of the airlines going out of business, despite the fact that they've received money. Yes, they've received tens of billions of dollars from the government already, but that was based on the assumption that air travel will resume the way it was, let's say by August, September, October. And though I see domestic air travel improving faster than international air travel, I still don't think it's going to be enough. I think that the airlines, when they reopen, may have to resort to giving up that middle seat. And that is a massive amount of revenue to give up that middle seat. And you know, if they don't do that, they're simply going to see empty flights. So there's definitely a wave of bankruptcies coming.
And you
I hope
know
that doesn't
what?
happen.
I also, I also
I hope it doesn't happen with the middle seat, because then I don't know where my friend is going to bring her dog. How's she going to do that on a plane?
That's right. Yeah, that's where the dogs go, right?
Yeah. But listen, you know, Neal, before we close out this podcast, I want to circle back to what you were talking about before about the government bailouts and everything else that has to happen as we reopen America, reopen society in general. Do you think from a real estate perspective that maybe third quarter this year or even fourth quarter this year is too early to start looking for bargains, or will people have to wait more, again, from a real estate investing perspective?
I think third quarter is too early. Good portions of the real estate market are frozen. And when I use the word frozen, I don't mean that there's no transactions. I mean like transaction volume might be down 50% or more. And I don't expect that to change in the month of May. But by June, you're beginning to see a slow unfreezing. And that unfreezing will be both good and bad. You will see more transactions. You'll have more choices. But now you'll also see buyers putting pressures on sellers to reduce pricing. Because there's, in this post-coronavirus world, in a recession, you typically can't price real estate as aggressively. You get less offers, and so prices get pushed down. So I think that there's going to be pressure on prices in the June, July, August, September timeframe, and that pressure over 3 to 4 months is going to cause prices to fall. So you definitely could see deals in Q4. Maybe you'll see them in Q1 as well. It really depends on the governments. At this point, the governments of the world have to do some extraordinary things. And if we thought that our governments already did the extraordinary things by shutting it down, the answer is nope, they did half of the extraordinary things. The other half relates to getting consumers to spend again. And that is going to be an extraordinary amount of money that it's going to have to be put in. So how real estate does in Q4 is really heavily dependent on the government response. But inevitably, I expect there to be a decline in real estate prices. I think you'll see some decline in single family. You'll see some decline in multifamily. You'll see large declines in retail centers and strip malls. You'll see large declines in areas that are tied. You could potentially see large declines in some kind of office segments, maybe not in technology-heavy markets. You'll see large declines in hotel pricing. I think that Vegas is going to be, unfortunately, one of the markets that's hit the hardest. So there's going to be a lot of decline in travel-heavy markets like San Francisco, Orlando, Miami. You're going to see, fairly large declines there because those are domestic and international travel markets. So it's going to be very uneven. But the answer to Ron's question is, yes, there's going to be bargains. Q4 probably will have more of them than Q3. Even back in 2008, it took time for prices to go down. They didn't just crash one day. Real estate takes a while, and so there's always this lag. I really don't see a realistic scenario where real estate prices do not go down. They will go down, but I feel that it's also highly unlikely that they will go down like 2008.
Yeah, and out there, there's probably nobody better as far as multifamily knowledge than you are. Based on the numbers that you're seeing, are people paying rents? What are their collections like these days?
Well, I have to say we're all breathing a big sigh of relief. So today is the last day of the month of April, and the month of April was phenomenal. If at the beginning of April somebody had told me that I would have collected, that the apartment industry would have collected, roughly 90% or slightly higher than 90% of the rents that they were supposed to collect, I wouldn't have believed them. What this does is it shows how inflexible rent is. People pay rent even if they don't have jobs. Not all of the people that paid us rent in our huge apartment communities had jobs, but they paid rent because the fear of not having a roof over their head in the middle of a pandemic was incredible. Some of those people are going to start getting their checks from the government next month. They're going to get unemployment checks, both from a state and a federal level. So we think that for a significant amount of time, this is going to go well. But we still think that there's risk. If we do not recover, to the point where 90% of these people that have been unemployed go back to work in the next 2 to 3 months, then we could start to see a destabilization in the apartment industry. That is a low chance In my mind, statistically, I think that's a low chance. I think the apartment industry will do fairly well. But will prices go down? Yes. I don't think that there's a way to avoid a decline in prices in the apartment industry. I just don't think rents are going to go down much. In 2008, prices for single-family homes went down 30 to 70%, depending on your metro. Rents nationwide only went down 5%, and all of that was in 2009. 2008, rents were positive. 2010, they were extremely positive. So we had one decline, and it was 5%, which is not really the end of the world. You know, we've had 5% annualized increases for a number of years. Having one year where they go the other way, it's not a big deal, right? So I don't think rents are going to destabilize. In certain parts of the country, I think home prices could destabilize for, you know, based on that area and how much it gets hit. Certain areas are definitely more likely to see a hit. Like San Francisco, their economy is so tourism dependent that you could see a significant hit to the prices there. So, yeah, we're going to see a hit, and then we're going to see some bargains as well. So that's the good news. There's bargains coming.
Yeah. And then we talked about the retail and office space probably getting hit pretty hard. Do you think that the medical office subcomponent of that might be a little bit safer, or do you think they're going to hit hard too?
I think the medical office space is probably the safest space outside of industrial. I think industrial is going to be the big winner. Imagine this. We were a just-in-time country where we had 4 days of everything. We had 4 days of hand sanitizer and 4 days of toilet paper, and then it was all gone. Well, people are learning that that wasn't a very good idea, America. So now we're going to switch to a system that's going to be probably a two-week system. We're going to have more stock. Well, we're going to need hundreds of millions of square feet of warehousing in this country just to get back to where we were. We're going to stock more food. We're going to stock more medicines. And we're definitely going to stock more toilet paper. It might actually become a currency. So to me, I think that industrial is the big winner here, but I think medical office is going to do really, really well. We're going to need to do a lot more infection control. There's going to be a lot of attitude changes. A lot of money is in, you know, private investment is going to go into infection control and related medical areas, and the demand for medical office is going to be very strong. Yes, there's telemedicine, but in the end, when we're sick, we want to go see a doctor, right? It's one thing to say I can work from home, but I think it's much more difficult for Americans to become used to seeing their doctor remotely. And keep in mind that there are things that a doctor needs to touch you for, right? I had a hernia operation a year and a half ago. I couldn't be diagnosed remotely because that guy needed to stick his hand, you know, where it hurts most, and kind of wiggle it around to kind of see what was happening. And, you know, it's kind of difficult to show your rash over Zoom or things like that. So I think telemedicine is an interesting concept, but I don't think that we are there yet. I think we need technology to grow a lot more. So I think medical offices will do well. I think retail is in the shitter. I looked at what happened in April in terms of what percentage of people paid rent in retail. It was a bloodbath. And they've been going through a bloodbath for the last 6 years because of the Amazon effect, but they'd happily take that over this because this is a true bloodbath. So I think the retail industry in the United States, for the most part, if they're not grocery anchored, are going to destabilize. We're going to see some horrible, horrible things happen there. Same thing with hotel. We don't know how well or poorly hotels are going to do. It really depends on tourism and travel. I mean, you look at apartments, I'm crying tears of blood because I didn't collect 10% of my rents, right? Yeah, and you look at hotels, they only collected 20% of the money that they were making, and they still have to pay. I mean, month after month after month, lenders are not going to let them be. You might get a few months of forbearance, and that might get you through, you know, May, June, July, August. But what happens after that? Forbearance means you pay the money later, but you still have to pay it. Nobody's forgiving rent.
Right. Exactly.
So to me, I think the hotel industry is going to destabilize because I just don't see international and domestic travel coming back quickly enough for the hotel industry to be what it is. I think that industry shrinks, and we're going to repurpose it. We're going to use hotels for other things that will come out of this.
Well, but in Vegas, mm-hmm. we absolutely know about the hotels, the gaming, the entertainment. All of the things that keep people home is what Vegas is all about. And so
right.
Vegas is suffering severely because it can't mm-hmm. do any of the things it normally does.
Yep. Yeah, and you're going to yeah. see Vegas do all kinds of crazy stuff to attract people. You're going
Absolutely.
To see some insane offers that are going to be 10x what we saw in 2008 to get people from, you know, from wherever they are to McCarran Airport. And
That's
and,
right.
and you're going to see some nuts stuff come out of MGM and you know, all of the other big players in Vegas in the next, I think, eight or ten weeks. Some crazy
Neil, I think you just gave Vegas its new slogan. It was, you know, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Now it's going to be, you know, Vegas, you're going to see some nuts stuff here. You know, something like that.
Truly nuts.
So
there you go.
You just did it. Hey, I got one more question for you, Neil. Mm-hmm. I'm hearing self-storage is going to be a winner. Do you agree?
I think self-storage is going to be a relative winner. So I was very bullish about it. I'm slightly less bullish. But when I compare it to retail, when I compare it to hotels, it's going to be a definite winner. When I compare it to multifamily a month ago, I would have said I think it's going to do better than multifamily. Now I think it's going to be in that same sort of range because we did see a number of people that were sitting at home and had nothing to do. They went to their public storages and they emptied them out. They had time, which they never had before, because even in 2008, 10% of Americans were unemployed in 2008. The remaining 90% had to go to work, right? So
yeah. So
here you have this extraordinary scenario of all the people that are employed with companies who are paying their salaries still sitting at home. And because of that, there's been an impact on self-storage. So this is a different kind of recession. So to me, I would say I'm cautiously optimistic about the self-storage industry, but not as optimistic as I was 4 weeks ago.
And, you know, I think that a lot of companies are, like you said, going to go out of business, going to go bankrupt and have major impacts to them. But I think that eventually, over a period of time, all of those companies that closed or downsized or changed their income potential will revitalize themselves. And maybe this company goes out of business, but those people become creative and create a new company to take the place of the old company in the same industry or a different industry. So companies that are in distress now that maybe go out of business or go bankrupt will be replaced by new businesses that start over again, because those entrepreneurs, an entrepreneur is an entrepreneur no matter what happens. So if something happens detrimental today, it's going to cause them to adapt, to become creative, to become innovative, and create a whole new business that will work in the environment.
Yeah, and you know, I like to say something that gets me in trouble all the time, but it's to your point. Recessions are good for business. And a
Absolutely.
Lot of people are like, well, how can recessions be good for business? Well, because
Absolutely.
The problem is the longer an economic cycle goes, the longer an expansion goes, the more you have these hanger-on companies that are just hanging on for dear life. They're not structured. They're not technologically advanced. They're not innovative. But they're hanging on simply because the economy keeps growing 2 to 3% a year. And what a recession does is it cleans house, and it gives the truly innovative companies a chance to grow and gather a bigger market share. And America's
exactly.
stronger when our technologically advanced and more innovative entrepreneurial companies have a chance to grow market share. And now they're going to have that chance. That is why when a country comes out of recession, it grows faster than it did before a recession, because we've cleaned house. And now
right.
we have a stronger set of companies that are driving America forward. So recessions
Absolutely.
Can be a good thing.
Absolutely
yeah,
correct.
And then one more thing. Actually, I sound like Columbo there. Sorry about that. Neil, your company, you're still doing things for accredited and non-accredited investors, right? Is that right?
We are. So we have projects for accredited investors. We also have projects for non-accredited investors. Obviously, non-accredited investors have to approach us. We can reach out to accredited investors, but the non-accrediteds have to come into us. And we are doing projects, though we've scaled them back. We're doing smaller projects. We're doing projects that today are resilient. We're doing projects that today have multiple funding sources and multiple exits. And we're doing projects that are shorter duration. So all of those, I mean, if you look at our projects, you'll see that we very radically changed our product mix, and we've done it very, very quickly because we are a very adaptable company. So yes, projects, but they're smaller, faster, and they have multiple exits.
And people can find out about those projects at growcapitus.com, correct?
That's right. So that's GROCAPITUS.com. Another way of finding out more about our projects is simply Googling me. I happen to have the extreme luck and the extreme misfortune of being the only Neal Bawa on the internet. So if you type in N-E-A-L and my last name Bawa, B-A-W-A, I'll come up, and then you can basically connect with us. The best way to really learn more, though, is to go to multifamilyu.com. That's multifamily followed by the letter u.com. That's our Multifamily University website. We do webinars there. We do at least one a week, sometimes two a week. We do podcasts, and it's very powerful. There's about 50,000 people attending our webinars. There's hundreds of thousands listening to our podcasts. And that's really where you can learn more about the content. And if you feel like it's something that's interesting to you, feel free to connect with us, and we'll be happy to show you our upcoming projects.
Yeah, and I could definitely give you a testimonial on that one too, because I go to that site all the time. And it's almost like if you were just there and you spent, you know, literally hours watching all that stuff and digesting all that material, you probably would get a better education than you would if you went to a four-year college for real estate. So you did a great job on that, and the information that you put out there is always really just top-notch.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks so much.
I concur in that, absolutely.
Yeah. Vicky, do you have anything you want to say before we close this out? This is another great podcast. You know, Neal, amazing job today. Amazing.
Thank you.
It's always such a pleasure to have Neal on our podcast because he gives so much information, so much knowledge, and he does it in a way that's not entertaining so much as it just causes you to kind of forces you to remember it because you have no choice because he presents it so well.
Thank you. That was $20 each for both of you. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Well, let me try again and maybe bring it up to 50.
Well, you want to get up to 50?
I <That's good. laughs> I find the entertaining part of it is the positive part, right?
Yeah, I
think there's a lot of positive.
That's
Neal,
great. That's
I will
great.
Never in my entire life forget the little ditty that you did about how to grow better tomatoes. That is stuck in my brain forever.
Sounds good. That's my favorite as well.
Yeah. All right. Folks out there, you're listening to the Mapable USA podcast at mapableusa.com. If you go to that website, scroll down the homepage, you'll see all our syndication sources. Just pick the one that you like best. Subscribe, and you'll never miss another podcast episode. So once again, thank you, Neal Bawa. Actually, if you want to be a guest on today's show like Neal was, there's a guest tab on our website as well. Fill that out. We'll see what we can do about getting you on the show. So thanks again, everyone, for listening. Thanks for subscribing. Thanks for your support. And we'll be at you next week with another Mapable USA podcast. Have a great week, everyone.